this world. So Krishna is speaking these verses. For one who explains this supreme secret to the devotees, pure devotional service is guaranteed. And at the end, he will come back to me. There is no servant in this world more dear to me than he, nor will there ever be one more dear. Purport. Generally, it is advised that Bhagavad Gita be discussed amongst the devotees only. For those who are not devotees will understand neither Krishna nor the Bhagavad Gita. Those who do not accept Krishna as he is, and Bhagavad Gita as it is, should not try to explain Bhagavad Gita whimsically and become offenders. Bhagavad Gita should be explained to persons who are ready to accept Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. It is a subject matter for the devotees only and not for philosophical speculators. Anyone who tries sincerely to present Bhagavad Gita as it is, will advance in devotional activities and reach the pure devotional state of life. As a result of such pure devotion, he is sure to go back home, back to Godhead. Om agyan timirandasya gyana jana salakaya chaksa-milita-mena-tasmai shri guru-dhyama shri chaitanya manavabhi sarsa-kita-vena-bhuta svaya-bhupa-kidamma-yam-dadati svapadantikam pandeham shiguru-shiguta-padakamalam shiguru-vaishnavamsha Shirupam Sagrajatam Sagala Raghunatham Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Sarvadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Sri Radha Krishna Padam Sagala Lalita Sri Vishakam Vitamsha Hey Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinamandu Jirapate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radhakanta Namaste Namaste Sarasvati Deve Omogravani Vajrani Virashishra Shunyavani Ashtadhyavi Satarini Sri Krishna Chaitanya Nityananda Sri Shukriya Sri Vasari Yoga Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama explains the supreme secret to the devotees, pure devotional service is guaranteed. At the end, he will come back to me. There is no servant in this world more dear to me than he, nor will there ever be one more dear. Krishna is revealing his heart here, that this knowledge that he spoke is a supreme secret. For persons who are envious or not inclined to devotion, this material is not for them. And they can never understand it, nor do they really have the ability not to understand it. So generally, it's for the devotees. So we speak, and Prabhupada established every night in every temple around the world, the Bhagavad Gita class, going very systematically through the Gita, and devotees hearing and discussing this great science. Bhagavad Gita is Shruti. The Vedas are divided into Shruti and Shruti. Shruti is the actual Vedas, which makes up the Upanishads and the four Vedas, the Rig Veda, the Sama Veda, Dharma Veda, and Yajur Veda. The original Veda is the Rig Veda. But nobody can really understand Veda. No one has the ability, the intelligence, the acumen, nor the time to study Vedic scriptures. They're too intricate, too deep, and too broad. And so therefore, there is called a Smriti. Smriti is commentary on the Vedas, which is understandable according to time, place, and circumstance. So Krishna spoke Bhagavad Gita, which is Smriti, which is commentary on the Vedas. And what is he giving? He's giving the essence of the process of bhakti, which is to remember him, to become his devotee, to worship him, to surrender your life to him, to offer your obeisances to him, and to ultimately come back to him in devotional service. Now, people who are not inclined to these activities will never be able to understand the philosophy that is based on these activities. So, therefore, we don't speak to these persons. But then again, we do give classes in a general sense. And we also distribute Bhagavad Gita to people in general. So is there some discrepancy or some contradiction? No, if a person is a little inclined and is somewhat non-envious, then they're open to learn. And therefore those people also can enter into the knowledge of this great science. And therefore, it is the duty of the devotees to learn this science very carefully and be able to speak it whenever it's required. So, it's important that we read and study Bhagavad Gita. When you carefully read Bhagavad Gita, you'll find it is so nicely compact. Everything is so organized and so systematic. And so what we say, Prabhupada's purports are elucidative, they're effulgence. He's taking these very difficult statements by Sri Krishna himself. Who can understand the mind of the Lord? Although he speaks and he gives the words, it is very hard to understand what is he actually saying. Therefore we have the Bhagavad-gita purports, which are meant for us to read and discuss and to study, actually, and to be able to apply it in our life. So this is for everyone. It's not for just a select group of devotees who have certain intelligence or abilities to, attraction for philosophy. It is for everyone. Everyone should have a working knowledge of this. That way, whenever it's time, one can speak this knowledge to others. And therefore, one who does that, and Krishna says here, he emphasizes it in two verses. At the end, he will come back to me. That person becomes very dear. And then he says, there's no one more dear who explains this knowledge to others, nor will it be anyone more dear. So, Krishna is equal, samoham, samabhutesha, namedvesis, trinapriya. He's equal to everyone. He doesn't favor one person over another, but he reciprocates according to how the devotees approach him, or and even people in general. He says in the Bhagavad Gita, yayatamma prapadyante, tamstatayva bhajamyaham, mama vartmanam vartante, manusha partha sarvasyaha. As you approach me, I award you accordingly. So one who understands the knowledge of the Lord and lives according to that becomes dear. But one who understands the heart of the Lord becomes more dear. Understanding the heart of the Lord is that the Lord himself comes to this world. Why? Not simply just to perform his activities, but to entice the conditioned souls back home, back to Godhead. He comes in order to bring others back with him. So this is the heart of the Lord. He is eager for each and every living entity to come back into him in devotional service. As a father is inclined to each and every child, even though the child may, reject the father, even leave the father never gives up on the child. So the Lord's love is complete. doesn't love one living entity more than another, but he reciprocates on how one approaches him. So if we take that understanding of the Lord's nature, which is his nature, that he personally wants to come to show how important it is for the conditioned souls to come back to him. So anyone who acts on his behalf and takes up that service of trying to help others come back to him, as Krishna says, there's no one more dear, nor there will be anybody more dear. And we want to be dear to Krishna, right? Because if you're dear to the greatest person, then what else is left to do? There's nothing left. You have achieved perfection. Your life is perfect. We were speaking the other night of Bhakti Tirtha Swami. We had a program in Zagreb at a place where I stayed. And there was one, he made it his life to preach in countries that were behind the Iron Curtain during the 1960s, which was this area of the world, of course. This was Yugoslavia, communist Yugoslavia. And then there was Hungary, and of course Germany, Czechoslovakia, now it's Czechoslovakia, but it was Czechoslovakia at the time. Where else were we? He was also in, you know, Poland. And so he risked his life to bring Prabhupada's books to people behind the Iron Curtain. And he actually did, because if he was caught, he would have been either one of two things, put in jail for life or probably executed, either one. Because it was very severe, anybody who was preaching religion at that time would get very severe punishment. So when he came back, and Prabhupada was in London at the time, and Prabhupada's servant, Tamal Krishna Goswami, said to Prabhupada, "Your Ganesham," that was his name, Ganesham, "your Ganesham has come to see you." Prabhupada immediately got up from his desk, walked over as Ganesham came in the room, paid his obeisances, and got up. When he got up, Prabhupada did something that he rarely ever does. He did it about two or three times. He embraced him. Prabhupada never usually embraced his disciples. Once or twice that happened. And Ganesham, and while he was embracing him, he said, "Your life is perfect. You have achieved perfection. You have risked everything just to bring Krishna consciousness to people who would never have a chance to get these knowledge, these books." And now this area of the world is wide open now for those who risk their lives to come into this area. And I think this area, also in Croatia, and many other places, many devotees came and did this very difficult service. And so, this shows that how much a person wants to please the Lord. So, risking a little bit of our time, effort, ability, resources, our comfort, getting out of our comfort zone. There was no such thing as comfort zone when I joined the Hare Krishna movement. That was a cliche. Comfort zone was a person who sat down for 5 minutes. That was comfort zone. In those days, nobody sat down. In fact, we did everything on the run. We were moving all the time. We know there was no stopping. The time we got up in the morning to the time we went to sleep, and going to sleep was easy. It was easy. Before your head hit the pillow, you were out. On your way down, you were out. So, because devotees, Prabhupada really inspired the devotees to work so hard, distributing books and traveling and preaching, opening up centers, performing Harinam Sankirtan. There's always a couple of devotees in the temple to maintain the temple, and the rest were out. They were out preaching. So this is how Krishna consciousness spread so fast. around the world, that devotees were just willing to do anything just to give Krishna consciousness to others. And some of the risks they took were unbelievable. Unbelievable risks. Going into jails, going into communist countries, going into places where people were very hostile and didn't want them there still. But that was the way. That sacrifice brought Krishna's mercy in such a powerful way. So therefore, when we read this verse, then we can understand how clear everything is. It is our legacy. Legacy means what's been handed to us from our acharyas to give Krishna consciousness to others. So when they do that in different ways. But the devotees should be very knowledgeable of this philosophy. It looks very awkward and even sometimes embarrassing if we don't know the philosophy that we're trying to practice. So therefore, to take time and read and study these books and practice preaching. I remember when I was a kid, I'll talk a little bit about my growing up, one of the most fearful things in my life was public speaking. I was not afraid, I would collapse, turn colors, shake, and sometimes run. I was so scared to speak in front of audiences. Especially, you would have to give a talk in your class on some paper you wrote or something like that. I was always absent that day. And then, even when I became a member of the Hare Krishna movement, I couldn't speak clearly. I didn't want to really do anything to be like in the front or to talk or anything like that. But then, I took sannyas, and then one devotee told me something which I'll never forget. He said, sannyas means you have to be ready to speak at any time, at any place, on the spot. Because sometimes we think, I have to speak, let me prepare for my talk. But he said, no. He said, this means you have to be ready at any time. And Prabhupada has also said that in a general sense, devotees should be able to speak Krishna consciousness whenever it is required to each other and, of course, to people in general, the non-devotees. So, therefore, we need to, but just to go to classes and to hear the classes is nice. But how I learned to, of course, I'm still learning. But how I learned to preach is I used to do traveling sankirtan. I had one partner with me. It was two of us. We would travel in these Ford vans all over the United States. And I would park, pick up a book, and I would give class to my partner. And that's how I started, just one speaking down to one person, because I was too scared to speak to more than one person. But then as you practice the speaking of what you read, here, and then it becomes more natural. And then Krishna sees, this person wants to do something, so he helps. He helps the devotee along. Otherwise, what is our ability to present this very difficult to understand philosophy in a very easy to understand way? It's not easy. But if we practice and have classes of how to give class. Have classes on how to give class. There was one sannyasi, he wrote a book, which I have, How to Give a Good Class. And he explains all the principles on how to present the knowledge in a very, a setting of one person speaking to a large group. And so, these things are very, helpful for us to get the confidence we need and the enthusiasm also to preach Krishna consciousness to others. And this is what we want to do because Prabhupada said every devotee should be able to give Krishna consciousness, whatever is required, to everyone, anyone, at any time, at any place. And so the world is in bad need of this knowledge. They have so much knowledge, the stars are full of books, the internet is full of information, which is all useless and trash, mostly. It doesn't really help anybody. And people are more disturbed than ever. The rate of, I just posted this on my conference just about a week ago. The suicide rate in the United States increased 25% in the last 2 decades. 25%. That's 1/4 of the. So, and I was just reading in the news yesterday that 31% of the American population says there'll be a civil war in the United States coming soon. People are so dissatisfied. And all around the world that dissatisfaction is coming. Why? Because they're all being led by leaders who have no qualities to lead and being taught by people who simply patron to sense gratification and economic interest and so on, which cannot satisfy people. And therefore, there is so much frustration. The world is so frustrated. I guess that's the word. Depressed is there, but frustration is there on every level. So it is the duty of the devotees, because we have this sacred knowledge. It's sacred, as Prabhupada, as Krishna says here. It's a supreme secret. It's not easy to understand. But if we make an effort to understand Krishna within the heart, Krishna says, Chahari. Sarvasi Jaham Pradisthani Visto Mata Smita Gyanam Apohanam Cha. I give you, if you want knowledge, I give it to you. If you want remembrance, I give you to. And if you want to forget, I also help you to forget. So Krishna is super soul in the heart of all living entities. He's there to fulfill our desires accordingly. But the desire has to be strong and focused. So if we have this mood, we have this wonderful temple, and we also have a wonderful yatra that is very vibrant. But we also have to see how to make it bigger and bigger and bigger. We want the whole country of Slovenia to become devotees. So, and then that's not enough. So the idea is that Prabhupada said, one of my problems is I can't think small. That's one of my defects. I can't think small. But Prabhupada always thought big. And he taught us the same way. Think big. Go for something big. He used that phrase, shoot for the rhino. I think Shama Sundra has written a book based on a Prabhupada statement. He called it Chasing the Rhinos. But Prabhupada used the word shoot for the rhino. The rhino is a very powerful animal. And it's big and it is fast. And it runs and it's very vicious. So if it runs towards you, even if you have a gun, you can't stop it. But they have special guns for rhinos to stop them. So it's one of the hardest animals to catch. Anyone who catches a rhino is considered to be the greatest of all hunters. It's a powerful animal. So Prabhupada said, shoot for the rhino. And he said, if you get it, everyone will say, well done. And then if you didn't get it, people will say, well, it was difficult anyway. So in other words, you can't lose by going for something big. Shyam Sundar, who wrote the book, when he was in London, he was thinking, I want to do something big for Prabhupada. Let me think. So he thought, yeah, the Beatles. So he made his effort just to meet the Beatles and try. try to connect with them in Krishna consciousness. He saw they had a little sentiment towards Eastern spirituality, so he played on that sentiment to bring Krishna consciousness to them. And what he had to do to meet the Beatles wasn't easy. It wasn't easy at all. He had to sneak in a very private meeting. And it wasn't for Yoko Ono, the wife of John Lennon, she actually, you know, got him in, but it was difficult. And then he met George, and when he met George, he spoke to George for about 2 hours, and then George became very much convinced. And that opened the Beatles up in a very powerful way, and it spread Krishna consciousness fast. So here's an example of a person who took a big risk, and so then these risks, I mean, sometimes it's a little hard, but if Krishna inspires you, and you like to do these things, it's, so sometimes, you know, just like going out in book distribution, you don't know who's favorable and who's not favorable, but then you think, you just pray to Krishna to empower you to reach someone who would like to get this knowledge. So our enthusiasm, coupled with our intelligence, will inspire people to become interested in this great science and philosophy. So we want to somehow or other please Lord Chaitanya and to expand the family of devotees more and more and more. Sometimes there's a fear, oh, if we get too big, how will we take care of the devotees? Don't worry. Krishna can take care of the whole world. He can take care of the whole universe. He can take care of all the universes. He can take care of every living entity in existence. So it's not that we have to worry about these things. As we expand the preaching, Krishna will expand the facilities and the resources to do that simultaneously. That is Krishna. So, this is these two verses here are very fundamental. It comes at the end of the Bhagavad Gita, just before Krishna wraps up his final words. He wants to make the point. When you want to make a point in a particular presentation, you make the point at the beginning, and then you make things, you make points around the point during the middle, and at the end you re-emphasize the point again. So here he re-emphasized the point again. Yes, it's all about taking this knowledge, learning it, practicing it, and giving it to others. So we want to do that. So in order to do that, we need to make plans how to do it. Come together and brainstorm how to preach Krishna consciousness. We will never be fully happy if we don't become an instrument for Krishna's mercy to others. If you're only concerned about your own spiritual life, you will never really taste the happiness of Krishna consciousness. You will get some peace, you will get a little bit of security, and you will also make, but if you actually really want to understand this movement is about preaching. It is the essence of this movement is preaching. It is about reaching out to others. We are not, Prabhupada said, we are not happy simply, you know, and with whatever we do, and we want to make more and more people. And Prabhupada gave his life to preach. And the acharyas have there, they've taught us so much knowledge that we can use to bring people to Krishna consciousness. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he preached through the holy name, and he preached through his devotees in different ways. Lord Chaitanya made the entire subcontinent of India Krishna consciousness while he was there. The whole subcontinent was Krishna conscious when Lord Chaitanya was there. So that's how powerful he was. So therefore he wants us to also, and To put in a very succinct and very easy to understand way, if you make one person Krishna conscious, and that person goes back to Godhead, then you are guaranteed to go back to Godhead. If you can save one person from material life, that is considered the greatest of all service. Just one. Just one. But if you can save more, that's better. we sometimes think, how do I save myself? Well, try saving others and you'll save yourself. That is the best way to help yourself, is to try to help others, because we are not different from each other. We are connected to each other through Krishna. And when we connect others to Krishna, we also connect ourselves more with Krishna at the same time. Okay, so these are just some basic principles about preaching. I just thought I'd just do a little general overview. Any questions or comments? Yes, another?
Thank you for the question. My question is, at what extent can we actually take risks in business?
Prabhupada said you should take risks to the point where it will destroy your Krishna consciousness. But take a risk. Tamal Krishna Goswami made that same question. Prabhupada said, not to the point where our Krishna consciousness goes down. So, I mean, here's an example where one devotee, he wanted to preach to the intoxicated drunkards. So he would go into the bars and then distribute books there, and then sometimes in order to get their confidence, he would sit down and have a drink with them. And he was sincere to try to get them, but at the same time, he was putting his own Krishna consciousness in jeopardy. So that's an extreme example. And eventually, you know, he went down. So that's a foolish risk. So if you want to stay strong in your own Krishna consciousness, keep good in sadhana. Check your rounds carefully and early and carefully, and read Prabhupada's books regularly and discuss these books. Bodhiyam tas paras param katiyam tas chimangachat tasyanti cha ramanti cha. This is a verse from Gita. Prabhupada quotes often. Devotees feel happy discussing this knowledge about me, Krishna's. So, this knowledge is not just for reading, it's for discussion. It's meant to discuss. And when we discuss, we open up more and more avenues of knowledge based on the same things that we hear regularly. It's unlimited, this knowledge. So, and that's for everyone, the ladies too. It's not like the men have to preach and the ladies have to support the men. No. Everyone should preach. Some way or other. Any other questions? So, don't let your Krishna consciousness go down by taking a risk. But still, you have to go a little bit beyond the comfort zone. Yes.
Which types of preaching does Bhakti Kirtha Swami focus most these times?
What did Bhakti Kirtha Swami?
On which types of preaching would he focus the most if he was still present today here?
He focused on helping devotees who are struggling in their Krishna consciousness. He tried to inspire the women, to children, to people who were, you know, somewhat down and out. But on the outside, he was always directing his preaching to important people. He met big people in the world. Nelson Mandela, Muhammad Ali. He convinced Muhammad Ali, the great fighter, to become a devotee. And he was ready to join. But his wife stopped him. Yeah. He convinced Muhammad Ali. He was the greatest fighter in the history of fighters. And he was, you can see the pictures of him and Muhammad Ali. And many entertainers, people in business, people in the military. So he reached out to important people around the world. So he focused on important people. So we can do that also. There was one devotee in Italy, and he would also do that. He's no longer on the planet. He was a great book distributor. He would go to these big offices with these big CEOs and try to get them books. And he was good at it. So, yeah, you can also do that. If you want to watch miracles happen, take a risk. You can see Krishna's magic. Krishna's magic is not limited to the past. It's still the real. As soon as you get some ideas on how you want to reach out, you'll see Krishna, how he inspires you. He helps you. Practically, he does everything. But you have to be enthusiastic, and you have to be convinced. Even if you don't know the philosophy that good, that doesn't restrict you or limit you, or what we say. Disqualify you. Still, if you're enthusiastic, Krishna will give you the intelligence on reaching you. The Bhaktivedanta Swami went for the big people. A lot on the outside. He was giving classes to people in the Pentagon. He started a leadership course, and Pentagon generals were coming to his class. People in the military. That was at Washington University in Washington, D.C. Washington, D.C. gave him a special honor that was never given to anybody before in the entire city of Washington, D.C., which is the capital of the United States. The mayor of Washington, D.C. came from one of Maharaja's programs for after he had left. We were doing a program in Cleveland, and he came, and he gave an honorary plaque. You can still see the plaque. He dedicated one day a year to Bhakti Tirtha Swami in Washington, D.C. That was January 21st. So every January 21st is Bhakti Tirtha Swami's day in Washington, D.C. So this is how he reached big people, mayors, people who were big in government, leaders like that. He wanted to get on the Oprah. He said the last thing he wanted was the Oprah Winfrey show. He tried for that, and he almost got it, but it didn't happen. So yeah. And look what Radhanath Swami is doing. He's preaching to people in London. We did programs in the House of Lords, in the House of Commons. He's done programs with Google, with Apple, with many, many different big places around. So yeah, he's also doing big preaching with people. He's doing preaching with people through various medias, famous medias. What is that famous one? Huffington Post, Huntington Post. Yeah, that one got dissolved and redone again. The second biggest stock market company in the world is also, he's connected to that, doing programs there. So yeah, so he also met, you know, Obama twice. And he also met the president of India, also had darshan with the president of India. So, you know, if we become a little determined, we can do things. Because we have something. If we don't really know what we have, we won't be enthusiastic to give it. We got something that everyone needs. Everybody needs this knowledge. Otherwise, the whole world doesn't have any hope. It's all going down. The religions of the world are not able to help people. They can't. Because they've compromised their principles in order to connect with, you know, state and social, what we say, programs. They've compromised. Christianity compromised. All the major religions have compromised in order to allow them to function within. We're not compromising, but at the same time, we're not going against them either. We have something. Our knowledge is powerful. It's coming. Goloka Premadan Parinam Sankirtan. It's coming from the spiritual world, this knowledge. It's not man-made. Bhagavad Gita was spoken by Krishna himself. If you learn Bhagavad Gita, you can preach anywhere and to anyone. Just Bhagavad Gita alone, what to speak about Srimad Bhagavatam. Very powerful knowledge. Okay, any other questions? Yes.
How properly connect bridge preaching and direct preaching?
How connected bridge preaching?
Yeah, because that we don't go to extremes if you just give a lecture directly.
The philosophy is you have to catch the fish without getting wet. You fall into the river trying to catch the fish, what's the use? So bridge preaching means you have to reach out to other areas and be able to bring them in without you going into their understanding and philosophy. And we see bridge preachers who try that and also became contaminated by the people they were trying to preach to. That happened in Vrindavan. We started interfaith preaching. We were inviting people from all different religions to come for conferences, but then some of the devotees got interested in these other religions and actually started practicing. And some of them actually left Krishna consciousness. So, yeah. So, bridge preaching means to reach out without somehow or other becoming influenced by the people you're trying to reach. And that's happening now in our society. People are bringing in certain elements which are very nice, but they're not transcendental. So most religions are not, they don't teach transcendence. They teach good works. Be kind to your neighbor, you know, be kind to the priest, be kind to the donation box. You know, in other words, they're more or less keeping their parishes and their followers together by doing, you know, a lot of social welfare work. It's mostly about social welfare. We sometimes do that with the idea of giving people, just like our Food for Life programs. I mean, food for life is just giving people prasad, food, but it's prasadam at the same time. But that's an end, so we can eventually make people favorable and then give them this knowledge. So bridge preaching requires some real thought, taking risk, understanding the level, what you're doing, how you're doing it, pull back, move forward. It's not so easy. But try it. Like, devotees are preaching yoga now. So yoga's good, because it's very much connected to our practice in one way. But if we become hatha yogis, then that's not the idea. So, yeah. Bhakti Tirtha Swami did a lot of bridge preaching. He was the main person who inspired that. And he sometimes took on the costumes, the dress. You can change your dress for preaching, there's nothing wrong with that. Prabhupada writes about that in the seventh canto, that for the sake of preaching we might use different dress to reach different types of people. Yes,
I have one, maybe small, idea. Tomorrow.
Small?
Idea.
Small what?
Idea.
Detail?
Yeah.
Idea.
Idea.
Tomorrow is Harinam Sankirtan. Mm-hmm. Devotee takes until five book. Challenge come.
Every devotee takes five books?
Yeah, going. New realization, new inspiration. Mm-hmm. Something happens. 100% something happens. Mm-hmm.
Usually there's one or two devotees who do books and then everybody does Harinam, but you can have more devotees doing books. Yesterday I went to Glina in Croatia for jail programs, and I was thinking, these jail programs are difficult because it's the most difficult audience to preach to, because they're sizing you up and seeing what you got and ready to challenge you in the slightest. But somehow, it was just myself, Prem Murthy, and one boy named Roberto, the three of us went. And 15 inmates showed up. At first they were like, but then, you know, I started to became a little more relaxed. And then, you know, I'm talking about different things. I talked about karma. I mean, it's really an interesting subject for not always karma, especially for guys in jail. So then I was talking about the holy name. And then at the end we had a kirtan. The first kirtan nobody chanted. The second kirtan practically they all chanted. And one person almost cried. He was getting very emotional. He came up to me at the end and explained how he was feeling. And we gave out 30 books. 30 books. So, and it was a completely successful. So when I walked in there, I was thinking, okay, here we go, Krishna. Please empower me to do something here. And so that's a tough audience, because I thought of them just come to check you out, or just to get away from doing what they usually do, to do something different. So, and it was rainy, And it was good because most people, when it's not raining, they're outside exercising. So the rain helped bring more people in. So I was thanking Krishna. And then at the end of the program, the rain stopped. So I mean, when I left there, I felt like, wow, thank you, Krishna. I was really nice. And there was one British boy there who didn't understand a word of Croatian. He was locked up in a jail there. And he came up to me and said, do you have any books in English? I really want some. So he connected with him and I sent him some books. So, you know, there's different ways you can reach people. You can go to nursing homes. You can go to hospitals. You can go to different kinds of self-help facilities around. And try, just try. Come in with different things. You can come in with kirtan, you can come in with, just some flyers. You can come in with some prasadam. Or you can try anything. You can try contacting these big people in your country. Your former president here, I don't remember, what was his name, Ananta? The former president who was favorable.
Dhanoshik.
Dhanoshik? Yeah. He took prasadam. He actually came to one of our festivals. He went right to our booth when he came to the festival. It was a big festival with different groups. He went right to us. And he was very renounced. He talked to the devotees. He was the president of his country for many years. He's no longer president. But there's an example. Somebody big who's influential. If you get an influence, this is how Buddhism spread. Buddhism spread because one king, named King Ashoka became really favorable to Buddhism, and he made his whole, area where he was king, he made it the national religion. And that happened in Vanavishnupur with King Birhambir when Srinivasacharya preached there. He became so inspired by Srinivas, he made that whole area Vaishnavas. And he demanded, you become Vaishnava or are you finished? King Birhambir wasn't a small guy, he was pretty heavy. Former dacoit who became king. So yeah, if you get an influential person who's favorable, and we don't really know what's happening behind the scenes. There's a lot of things happening behind the scenes you can't see with the seeds we planted over the last 50 years. There are a lot of people who are closet devotees, who are big people who practice on their own, kind of secretively. We don't make their practice so public. And there's other people who do. So we want to plant the seeds, and we want to also water the seeds. But planting is the first part. Book distribution is a very direct and powerful way to reach it. That should always go on, but then we should think, what else can we do? So there's preaching to the choir, that's us. Preaching to each other, we do that. And to make each other strong, so eventually as we become strong, we want to go out. We want to make the devotees stronger, so they go out and preach to others. Somebody said, Prabhupada, I think Prabhupada. What happens if everybody becomes a preacher, Prabhupada said, very good. How little temples go on, Prabhupada said, don't worry. So you can do it in different ways. Yeah. And tomorrow, you can do that. Devotees take some books and just meet the people on the streets. Let's hope the weather is nice. Any other questions?
One time, by Shetri Kapa would speak you have contact for five people, your day is perfect. Vaisheshika problem. Give one resolution, you go for street, and five people look Krishna, book is Krishna, your life is perfect.
Yeah.
It's no big problem.
Vaisheshika, has he ever come here? I should invite him. He was just in London for the London Rathayatra. Have him come here and give a seminar on book distribution. He's powerful. He is really powerful. You know, he goes up to people and comes up and just shakes their hand, asks them their name, gets to know them, and pretty soon they got a book. He's good. We have our Devananda Nittai. He's got his little, he's, you know, book distribution on wheels. That's nice. So that's a little gimmick that he's created, and it's nice. It works. People, it's a little novelty. People are bored, so if you do something different, it breaks them out of their boredom. Let's hope the weather is nice tomorrow. Even if it's not, we'll still go out. When the weather is nice, everyone's out. They come out too. Any other questions?
Okay,
thank you very much.
Yay! So, Alexandra Maharaj ki.